The second resurrection is not a resurrection unto glory. It is not a resurrection unto ruling and reigning with Christ. It is a resurrection unto judgment. Tonight we are in Revelation chapter 20, verse 11 down through verse 15. In recent months, I would probably say in recent years, in fact, in I believe it was 2006, there was a nonprofit organization started by the name of WikiLeaks. Anybody ever heard of that before? Everybody in here has heard of WikiLeaks at this point, because their reputation has grown in infamy as of late, especially for our election season, our presidential election season. And I want to preface what I'm saying with this disclaimer. By using this example, I am neither affirming or condemning their actions. I'm just using it to make a point. So, you're familiar with WikiLeaks and their leader, Julian Assange. He's been in asylum abroad there in London at the Venezuelan embassy, I believe. And essentially what WikiLeaks does is they come across classified, secretive information that unveils corruption and wickedness and just very sinister things. And they take this classified material and they publish it for all of the world to see. And we've become very familiar with this because no matter who you are, you cannot deny the fact that those things that were exposed through the dumping of these documents has affected even our daily life. It affects the outcome of all sorts of elections, presidential, senatorial, all sorts of elections out there. One of the politicians who will go unnamed had 30,000 private emails released to the public. WikiLeaks has been cited, I think, over 28 million times in court cases locally in our nation and abroad in the world. Because this information that they are disclosing, it reveals people for who they truly are. It's one thing to be something out in public. It's another thing for somebody to get a hold of your private life and put it all over the world wide web, right? What a scary thought. I've even heard some of the political commentators that I'll listen to from time to time, they'll say that people will come to them and ask them, will you run for president one day? Will you run to be our senator? Will you run to be our governor? And their response is, no, I'll never do that because the world just has too much information on me. They would just slaughter me. They've got too much information on me. I'd never stand a chance. So really what's being promoted is you can look good in the public eye the more that you hide, the more reality that you hide, and you just project this image. What a scary thought that somebody could come across all of your private information, all of your private documents, everything that you have ever put a pen to or hit the stroke of a keypad, and they could take all of those hidden searches and hidden things that you've written, and they could just publish it for everyone to see. What would that do to you? It's terrifying, isn't it? For everybody in here, everybody in the world, that thought is terrifying. The reality is that God keeps such a registry. God keeps such a registry of every thought, every intention, every unspoken word, every word spoken under the breath, every word spoken behind a closed door, every malicious, hateful, lustful, arrogant, prideful thought, desire, action that we have ever taken. God has kept a perfect record of all of those things, and that scares me to death. That ought to sober us to the nth degree. And the reality is that someday in the future, because this is our Father's world, He's going to bring all of these things into account. And He is going to judge every single person according to that perfect registry of our deeds. I'll tell you what, if I stand on trial before God and I have to give an account for everything that I have ever done, so many things I've done that I've forgotten about, and I have to give an account, I have nothing to say. I'm guilty as charged. The only hope that I actually have is that God looks at me and He sees the faith that I have placed in Christ. And He looks at Jesus, and upon Jesus' back, in His wounds, in His stripes, in the holes in His hands and His feet, He sees all of my sins written on Him. And He says, Jordan, you are guilty as it gets, and you are deserving of hell as anybody in history ever has been. But because you placed your faith in Jesus, your name is saved. Your name is written in this book over here, and you are free to go. Not because you deserve it. No, Jordan, by grace, you have been saved through faith. I want you to write this down. Take your pen out, and I want you to write down this sentence. And remember it and think of it when you read this passage. Write this down. Because God will judge each person according to their deeds, I must be certain I'm saved under the name of Christ. Because God will judge each person according to their deeds, I must be certain I'm saved under the name of Christ. That is my plea. We sang the song on Sunday, before the throne of God above, I have a perfect plea. What's my plea? It's not that I'm deserving of heaven, I'm deserving of hell. My perfect plea is that Jesus has absorbed all of the punishment for all of the corruption that I have ever engaged in. So I'm free to go. I am safe. I'm saved. And what am I saved from? I'm saved from God. I'm saved from God's wrath, and I'm saved for God's grace. Because Jesus has fulfilled justice's requirement. Last week, rather the week before, when we looked at Revelation chapter 20, verse 1 through 6, we examined the first resurrection, the resurrection of the righteous, the resurrection of the faithful in Christ. And we looked at passages like 1 Thessalonians 4, where the Apostle Paul is comforting the church at Thessalonica, and he's telling them, these believers who you knew, who died before you, don't think that God has forgotten about them. The dead in Christ will rise first at the trumpet blast. When Jesus returns, the dead in Christ will rise first. And that's the reality that's taught in Revelation 21 through 6, that when Jesus returns physically, literally, and visibly for all of the world to see, that the graves of the faithful in Christ will be opened up and the dead in Christ will rise, and they will rule and reign with Jesus for 1,000 years here on the earth. Then you saw in verse 7 down through verse 10 of Revelation 20 that after those 1,000 years is completed, that Satan is released on the earth and he goes about in the kingdom of God, in the kingdom of Christ, and he gathers up all the lawless people, all the lawbreakers. These are the armies of Gog and Magog, and they try to march. They set their face against Christ and against Jerusalem, the beloved city. And as they approach Jerusalem, fire comes down from heaven and consumes those armies, and Satan is cast away into the lake of fire. And that brings you up there to verse 11 in Revelation 20, where John begins to see another stage of Revelation unfold. When I spoke of the first resurrection 2 weeks ago, I made a point that in saying the first resurrection, what am I implying? you imply that there is a second resurrection. Most people don't realize that there are two resurrections of the dead. There are two resurrections from the dead. And when you read the Bible carefully and closely, you start to see this all over the place. In fact, Jesus in the Gospel of John, early on, he told his disciples, John chapter 5, verse 28 through 29, he said, "Do not marvel at this, for an hour is coming when all who are in the tombs will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of judgment." There's two resurrections. There is the resurrection of those who died in Christ. They said, "God, you know all my rotten deeds." That was my prayer before I got up into the pulpit. "Lord, you know what I'm about to say, and you also know all of my rotten deeds. My only plea before you is that Jesus covers me." And those people who place their faith in Christ, they're raised up from the dead. The second resurrection is not a resurrection unto glory. It is not a resurrection unto ruling and reigning with Christ. It is a resurrection unto judgment. Look at verse 11 of Revelation 20. It says, "Then I saw," this is John, he's having a vision here on the island of Patmos. "Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. And from his presence, earth and sky fled away, and no place was found for them." Who is the him on the throne, the H-I-M, the him on the throne? Who is that? There's a lot of debate that goes on about who that actually is. The easy answer is to say it's God. I think when you look further and you really dig into Scripture, the answer comes out very clearly. In fact, in Romans chapter 2, the Apostle Paul tells you exactly who is the him seated there on the throne. Romans 2:16, he says, "On that day, when according to my gospel, God judges the secrets of men by Christ Jesus." This is Jesus who is seated on the throne of God. He is God himself. He is seated there and he's taking his seat in order to judge the nations. It's quite a different picture, isn't it, than what we see pictured for Christmas, isn't it? It's quite a different picture than we see when we celebrate and mourn Good Friday and we see Jesus hanging there as a criminal, half naked, humiliated and dead on the cross. In this picture, he's seated on a great white throne. And it says, "From his presence, earth and sky fled away, and no place was found for them." That sounds like figurative language, doesn't it? Earth and sky fled away. You say, well, earth and sky, they can't flee. They are fixed in the cosmos. They are fixed by God. In fact, the Bible tells us that this is going to happen, that this is not figurative language at all, that the earth and the sky fleeing away, that is a literal depiction of what's going to take place. In Psalm chapter 102, verse 25 and 26, the psalmist writes, "Of old you laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you will remain. They will wear out like a garment. You will change them like a robe, and they will pass away. But you are the same, and your years have no end." If you were to turn on the news channel, or you to go search on the internet and start to search about how the earth is coming unwound, how the earth is beginning to be destroyed, what you're going to read is that earth is being destroyed by man-made activities. We're putting too many pollutants in the air, doing too many things at the refineries, and I can't say that here, but doing too many things at the refineries, and we're just killing the ozone layer, and the earth is being destroyed because we're drawing up all the oil out of it, and the animals are going extinct. And yes, we should be good stewards of the creation that God has put us in charge of. But one thing that we understand from Scripture is that the world's undoing is not going to come at the hands of men. The world's undoing is going to come at the hands of God. When he returns, when Jesus is seated on his white throne, it says that the earth and the sky are going to flee. That word flee is the word phugeo. It's where we actually get our word for fugitive. that the earth and the sky are going to look at the judgment of Christ, and they are going to be rolled up like a scroll. They are going to flee. In fact, Peter gives us a little more information. In 2 Peter chapter 3, he describes this fleeing as an actual burning. That what happens when Jesus is seated on the white throne is that earth and heaven are burned away. He says this in 2 Peter 3, 11 and 12. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn? You see the idea that Peter is conveying there? Couple that with these texts there in Revelation, and the picture you get is that when Jesus is seated on his throne and he is prepared to judge all those who have been raised up from the dead, he's also passing judgment on the earth and the skies. And so he burns them just like a refiner will burn gold, will burn some precious metal, and they'll burn away all of the things that are worthless, and only the things that are worthwhile, only the things that are good will last. It says all of the earth will pass away. The heavens will pass away. Later on in a letter to the Corinthians, the Apostle Paul talks about ministers and their work for the gospel, and he says that on that day that the judgment of fire is going to reveal what each man's work was really worth. That if a man began in the church built on Jesus, the Christ, and the apostles, if he builds on that foundation with wood, hay, and stubble, that when the heavens melt and the earth is wiped away through fire, that nothing that he did is going to last. But if he instead built on Christ and the apostles, that wonderful foundation, if he built on there with precious materials, gold and silver and jewels, that will last in the judgment. And Paul says very frankly, and he will receive a reward for that. Look at verse 12. Because my question, When I look at this, the great white throne, and I'm going to read more about Jesus judging all those, all who have raised from the dead, my question then becomes, who is judged? Who is judged? Is it just a certain sect of people? Some people, majority of people, all people? Is there some exclusion, some exemption from this judgment? Look at verse 13. Verse 12, rather. It says, "And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Then another book was opened, which is the book of life." It says, "I saw the dead, great and small." What you read later on in verse 13 through 15 is that death and Hades and the sea have all given up their dead. Everybody is awake at that point. Everybody is there before the throne of Christ, before the great white throne, and they are giving an account. And notice what John describes here. He says that as the dead are raised, he says there are both great and small who are standing there before Christ. Helps you to understand that neither prominence nor obscurity is going to exempt anybody from this judgment. Neither prominence nor obscurity is going to exempt anyone from this judgment. So when we think about these WikiLeaks dumps, and we think of all the information that's given out through that, who are we judging at that point? We're judging prominent people. We're judging their actions. Well, what do we think about ourselves? We think, oh, nobody notices me. They're not going to do that to me because really I'm inconsequential. What I'm doing is inconsequential. But they are nation movers, people shapers. What they do does matters, right? But no, in the end, what does he say he sees before the throne of Jesus? Both great and small. Neither prominence nor someone's obscurity. There's no corners to hide in when Jesus burns away the heavens and the earth. There's nowhere to hide at all. Everything is exposed, it says in the book of Hebrews, Hebrews 4. Everything is exposed to him to whom we must give an account. says in Romans chapter 2, verse 6, that in that day he will render to each one according to his works. So what you see from there, the great and small, neither prominence nor obscurity excuses anybody from the judgment. You know what else you see when you read all of the Bible is that there are absolutely no exemptions from the final examination. No exemptions from it. Because think about this. Are Christians and unbelievers alike judged in that day? Or is it just unbelievers? What does the Bible tell us about our responsibility to give an account for the things that we do? So does the Bible tell us, does the Bible tell us that we have the liberty now that we are in Christ to do as we please with no accountability? Well, Paul says in Romans 6, what shall we do then, brothers? What shall we say? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Is Paul saying that just because Jesus has died for us, that we don't have the liberty to continue on sinning? That is what he's saying. But what if we did continue on sinning? What if we did take advantage of the grace of God? What if we did continue on sinning? Are we going to give an account for that, or is that what only unbelievers do? I think at this point the Bible is very, very clear that there are no exemptions. Every human being that has ever been created will give an account before God at the judgment seat of Christ. Read a couple of passages for you, just a couple for time's sake. You can see me afterward if you like for more references. Romans chapter 14, verse 10 through 12. Paul says, why do you pass judgment on your brother? Who is he writing to? He's writing to the church at Rome. He's writing to Christians. Why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or you, why do you despise your brother? For we, who's included in we when Paul writes this? Paul, the Apostle Paul, he says, for we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then, he says in Romans chapter 14, verse 12, so then each of us will give an account of himself to God. Each one of us, Paul says, me included. That means me included as well. I'm going to give an account for the things that I have done in this life. 2 Corinthians 5, 9 through 10. Paul says, so whether we're at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. When he says home or away, he's saying in this body, we are away from God. With God, we are home. So whether home or away, we make it our aim to please him. Why do we make it our aim to please him? He says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Elsewhere, Paul tells us that we will give an account for every idle word that we say. Just because Christ's blood covers us does not mean that we will not be accountable for the things that we say and do. We are accountable for those things. There is one difference. There is one chief difference in what's going to take place there at the judgment from a lost person, an unbeliever, and a person who is a believer in Christ. It says in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. It doesn't say that there's no judgment. It doesn't say that there's no accountability. No, there will be accountability. There will be judgment. Even a minister's work is going to be refined by fire. And there's going to be much of what God looks at that takes place in the pulpits and in the church. And he says, that's worthless. It's burned up. You get no reward for that. You're getting by the skin of your teeth, bud. But in Christ, there is therefore now no condemnation. So whereas I am accountable for the things that I've done, and I may come to God with an empty checkbook, He looks at my account and He says, there's no condemnation in you because in Christ I have already condemned all of your sins. You get no reward, but you enter into all the glory that is set before you. Look at verse 13 through 15. Start at verse 12. He says, and I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Then another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books according to what they had done. You may ask, how are we judged? He answers very plainly there, that there is a registry in heaven kept by God, kept by His angels, where He keeps a record of everything that is done on the earth. Everything done in the secret. What does He tell His disciples? The things that I've told you in secret, say on the rooftops. And the things that are done in secret in the end of days, they will be shouted from the rooftops. There's nothing done in secret that is going to be hidden there in the end. We're going to be judged by the things that are written in the books. He says, then another book was opened, which is the book of life. Notice that there are two different books here. There's two different sets of books, rather. There's a set of books with the deeds of men. And then there is one book over here with the names who are under Christ. The names of those who are in Christ, those who are saved and they are covered by Christ's blood. That is the book of life. It's spoken of there in Revelation 13, verse 8. So these books are used to judge. And he says, and the dead were judged by what was written in the books according to what they had done. Look at verse 13. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it. Death and Hades gave up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one of them, according to what they had done. According to what they had done. Many people make the contention, and I've brought this up to you before, that when they get to heaven, that they're going to have some sort of arguing match with God. When they stand before God to give an account, the point a finger, shake a fist, and tell God just how unjust He was to them, and there's going to be some sort of argument there, and they're going to let God have it. But how does Revelation 20 describe the judgment? It says there's not going to be an argument that takes place here. How is a person going to be judged? They're going to be judged according to what they did, according to what a person did here on the earth. There's no argument there. There's no contention with God. There is a legal document kept in heaven, a registry of everything that's been done. And according to that, we are judged. Notice what he says about the dead who are raised. He says that the sea gives up its dead, death gives up its dead, Hades gives up its dead. And we could go into a long, lengthy explanation about what these three represent. And I really think that these three are put together to say everybody who is dead. The dead in Christ have already been raised at the second coming of Christ. But then everybody else who has died, all those who have remained, they are also going to be raised up. There's no exemption here in these last days at all. Look at verse 14. The consequences of this judgment. Then it says, then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. It's an interesting term, isn't it? This is the second death. We've already read about the lake of fire there in verse 10 of chapter 20. Look at this description. It says, and the devil who had deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur where the beast and the false prophet were. And they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. It erases the picture of Satan enjoying hell, doesn't it? Satan doesn't enjoy hell. The demons, the fallen angels, they don't enjoy hell. The Antichrist, the false prophet, they don't enjoy hell or the lake of fire either. And it says that all those who are judged here at the judgment seat of Christ, those whose names are not written in the book of life, it says that they die a second death. As death and Hades are cast there into the lake of fire, he says this is the second death, the lake of fire. It's an interesting way of talking about death. as people on the earth, one of the things that occupies most of our thinking is the thought of death. In fact, as you get older, what I'm noticing is I think about it more. It becomes more of a reality, especially the more funerals that I attend, the more people whose hospital rooms I come in and the cables have already been removed. And I start to realize that this person who died, they're only 24 years older than me. They're not that old. You see people who are dead and they're younger than you. And it begins to be a real reality. I get on the airplane a few months ago to go to school. And as I'm getting on that airplane, it just dawned on me. When you get back, you need to really up your life insurance. Because you just don't know. You had better make sure that your family is well taken care of, because you don't ever know. And it starts to say, and you start to think about death. But the reality is, as frightening as death might be to a human, the first death is not the worst death that some will experience. It's not the most terrifying death that some will experience. For those who are not in Jesus, they will die twice. I heard somebody say this today. Those who are born once die twice. And those who are born twice die once. So those who are born twice, they die once. It's a reference to John 3, isn't it? When Jesus has his conversation with Nicodemus. And he tells Nicodemus, you must be born again. You must be made new. The Apostle Paul elaborates on it. Any man who's in Christ, he is a new creation. The prophets talk about God creating in a man a new heart. That's what David prays for. Create in me a clean heart, O God. The prophets talk about God taking out a heart of stone and placing within a man a heart of flesh. And that's the new covenant promise of God, to make a person brand new, to bear them again. That's what we celebrate when somebody is baptized. When somebody says, in my heart, this is what's taking place in my person before God. The old me has died. And he's buried in the ground. And the new me in Christ is raised to life. I have been born again. I've been made new. I've been brand new. And what that second birth guarantees is that there won't be a second death. That new birth guarantees that at that judgment seat of Christ, God will not send you away into the lake of fire, into the second death. But those who are born once die twice. Those who just live this life for themselves and continue on doing everything that they want to do apart from God, and they live this life. What do they say? You only live once. What terrible theology. You only live once. No, you live on forever. Question is, where do you live on forever? If you want to live on forever, you got to die to your old self and you got to be born again. Then death and Hades, verse 14, were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And you notice there in chapter 20, verse 10, speaking of Satan, that the lake of fire is eternal. It's eternal torment. The idea that a person is put into hell or put into the lake of fire, or when they die, things just go black and they disappear. They have no more consciousness, no more awareness of their existence. That idea is foreign to Scripture. I brought this passage out last week. Mark chapter 9, verse 47 and 48. Jesus talking about the terrible nature of the lake of fire. Notice what Jesus says about how horrible hell is. He says, and if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out. Can you think of anything in your body that is more precious than your eyes? Yet Jesus says, if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into hell, where their worm or their soul, their person, does not die and the fire is not quenched. The idea that death brings on this eternal state of non-existence is foreign to Scripture. The Bible tells us clearly that we have a beginning point, but we have no end. We are created to be eternal beings. The question is, where do we dwell there for eternity? Verse 15 says, and if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. When I read verse 15, I read terror. That someone is standing there before God and they give an account for everything that they've done, and yet their name is not in the book of life. They have no more recourse, no more argumentation, no more life to live, to change their mind, no more opportunity to come to Christ. And you could imagine somebody saying, check the book. Check the book again, God. My name has got to be in there, Lord. My name was on the church roll. There was a day that I got baptized. Is it in the book? God says, depart from me. I never knew you. Because for that type of person, church is a show. Church is a way of culture. But Jesus is not their life. They're not left at all to follow him. They're not willing to follow Jesus. Just willing to say, I'm a Christian, but not real willing to actually be a Christian. Now, I can imagine people on that day saying, Lord, check that book again. Check the book again. And I can imagine God saying, I can check the book again, but it's not there. Depart from me. I never knew you, you worker of lawlessness. Jesus tells us at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, he tells his disciples, he says, in that day, God's going to look over all the people and he's going to take the righteous, just like a shepherd does. He's going to take the righteous and he's going to put them aside like the goats, and he's going to take the sheep, and he's going to take the unrighteous and put them to the other side just like the goats. He's going to make a separation, and it's going to be eternal, and it's going to be final, and there's no rewind, there's no do-overs. What we do with Jesus for real really matters. What we do with Jesus really matters. It's not enough for us to just say, I'm a member of a church, or I feel like I'm a good person. God's not going to go off of whether we feel like we're a good person. God's not going to go off of whether or not the world has condemned us for our actions, whether or not the world looks at us and say, well, you're not bad at this murder. No, God's going to judge us for our deeds alone. And we know the answer. All have sinned and fall short. There's none who is righteous, no, not one. I have one plea in that day. I have one hope as I stand before the white throne of Christ. Colossians 2, 13 and 14. And you, who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. So when God looks through his books and he sees all of the volumes of my evil deeds, He pulls out the ledger, Christ's book, the book of life, and he pulls up my name, and it says, paid in full on the cross by Jesus. And that's my only hope. That I, in this life, come to Jesus and say, Jesus, you know all the volumes of my wickedness. God, would you forgive me? You are Lord of my life. Though I haven't lived like it, you are. What does Paul say in Romans 10? For if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. What does the Apostle John say? If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. How is God just to let me go? How is he righteous to let me go, even when he looks at the volumes of my sin? He looks at the cross and he sees that my debt was nailed to that. Jesus died for me. I can see Jesus reading Colossians 2:13-14 over those who have called on his name at the judgment seat. Your debt nailed to the cross. Because God will judge each person according to their deeds. I must be certain I'm saved under the name of Christ. Would y'all pray with me?